Hi, I'm Ford and you're watching my Japanese metalwork channel. I've got an interesting little box to share with you today. It's the work of a 19th century artist, Japanese artist. And the interesting thing about this piece is that it's very much unlike all of his other work. So I'm going to introduce you to the artist and his oeuvre of work, and then we'll have a look at this surprisingly different box. So what we have here is a pair of bronze vases by Jomi Eisuke. His dates are 1839 to 1900. And he's working here in a style that you may think of as Japanese, but in fact, it wouldn't have been the kind of thing you'd see in a Japanese home or a palace or mansion. These kinds of works were made for the export market and were part of the fad in Europe and in America for Japanisme, that is to say, anything oriental and exotic from Japan. These are quite typical of Jomi Eisuke's work. These are 25 centimeters, so just a little less than a foot high. They're not huge, but what it does mean is that the inlay work is really rather detailed, and you can see really how cleanly the colors are differentiated. And that's really important in Japanese metalwork, that the colors are distinct and solid. These have clearly been cleaned, not by me, I hasten to add, and thankfully they've not been over cleaned. The bronze patina itself is nice and even. There's no blotching. The shibuichi leaves here have been cleaned quite a lot because the silver would have tarnished quite badly. And I can see that they've been cleaned because of the way the shibuichi is now very distinctly mottled. There's still traces of tarnish on the silver moon and on the crest. But all in all, these serve as good examples of the work of Eisuke, Jomi. And we'll have a look at a few more, because in fact, if you Google his name, you do see quite a lot of his work on the internet, that marvelous cornucopia of everything. So we'll have a look at a few more, so you can get a sense of what his work was like. So now we've come in close on one of the vases. So I say, again, one of the things to appreciate about this is how clean the colours are and how distinctly they're defined. They're not muddied or tarnished really badly. The bronze of the body, of course, is a distinct alloy that would have been cast. This bottom part is copper. These lines, possibly solder, might be inlay. I haven't handled these, so I couldn't say. But that's copper. These leaves, you might think they're copper, but in fact, these, in my experience, are not copper. There'll be another bronze that's inlaid into the body, and they've been treated differently to the standard patination to get this reddish color. First time I encountered these many years ago, I had to replace some leaves on a vase that were missing, and the existing ones were very, this color is a different tone to this terracotta brown of the copper. And I thought the originals were copper, but when I took one off to copy, it turned out to be bronze. So these are probably bronze. I've got some compositions that promise to be like this, but I need to do more tests. What I like about this is this gold ochre color of these leaves and the reddy brown and the black on the chocolate brown. It's a really lovely autumnal palette. And then these little daisies, the white and gold, just a really lovely contrast. The overall very convincing, naturalistic palette. And so here's the other one. Not quite as colourful, but actually I really like this tonal quality of the shibuichi, which, as I say, I don't think that's the original effect. I think that's a happy accident of time. That contrasted with the shakado leaves and the little dots of dew is really quite a lovely abstract composition. It's very, very tasty. And just that little moon in the background just adds a little bit of lightness, and the silhouette of the grasses as well. But again, all the colours nice and clean, very distinct. And all of the shapes really quite defined. And as I've said in a number of design-related films and so forth, that it's the negative spaces that are important. So if you look at all these little negative spaces, they're all quite interesting in their own right. Up here, these little, and there's something to think about when you're designing complex, you know, busy images. Every little space must be considered. It can't just be accidental. And that's what this artist has done so nicely. About a tidy piece of work. Now let's go and see if we can find some more of Jomi Eisuke's output. Right, so here's a Meiji period bronze vase by Jomi Eisuke. Again, exhibiting a really beautiful bronze pattern, slightly different tone to the previous one. And I might account for that by suggesting that the previous one might have looked like this when it was when it was newer, because I noticed the foot on the previous one, the one in the catalogue I showed you, the foot was glossy like this, but the body that had been cleaned had a more of a matte finish, almost like a slightly dried out chocolate bar. That often, in my experience, has happened where perhaps some zinc or some tin that was in the bronze composition has oxidized excessively, and when it was cleaned, that's then removed. And so the patina is now altered because certain components which affect how the light is reflected off the surface are gone. So the tonal qualities of the light in terms of color alters. And also that metal that's been removed through oxidative processes has in effect got a slightly matte surface because it's sort of been etched, whereas this hasn't. So you may find that were we to examine the metals of both vases, they'd be similar. And certainly bronze casters tended to be fairly consistent with the alloys because it was important that they knew what would be happening when the metal was molten and how they would patinate, in fact. So there's another pair that looks interesting. Different metal, here we go. These are described as being sentoku. Sentoku is sometimes used interchangeably with brass, but in fact sentoku is a distinctly different alloy that makes its first authentic appearance in Japan in the Meiji period. I think it did, in fact, come from China. So these are sentoku. Sentoku is characterized by this lovely golden tone. These are a little tarnished and discolored in odd ways, but not terribly ugly. You might just be able to see in the room, it's not the greatest photograph, a hint of crystalline structure, and that's a defining feature of sentoku. It has this very strong crystalline structure that's the as-cast structure of the metal. You can't forge it. It just shatters, in fact. And so that crystalline structure is called kesho in Japanese. And it, as I say, it's a defining feature of sentoku. And although brass can exhibit dendritic structure, it doesn't really exhibit a crystalline structure characteristic of sentoku. So it's one way of determining whether it's brass or, in fact, genuine sentoku. It's pity we don't have any bigger pictures. But the reason I brought this up is it's a different color. So the alloy has been chosen specifically for this tonal range. The reds and so forth are quite rich, quite handsome forms. And interestingly enough, Jomi Eisuke's own teacher was one of, I think, maybe the 10th generation of the Kaneya Gosoburo lineage of bronze casters in Kyoto. And I know a little of the character of his master because I uncovered some notes of his own patination recipes, which are in the book that I'm struggling to finish. And Gosoburo is actually quite dismissive of other bronze casters in Kyoto, perhaps rightly so. After 10 generations, you'd think they had you know, a pretty good reputation. But he talks of various patination procedures that he uses, and one in particular that he's famous for, and suggests that it can be done in easier ways, as many of his competitors do, but he derides them as being cheapskates and lazy and so forth. Of course, he's the only guy doing the real deal. But that gives you a sense of the rivalry and the background to many of these so-called humble artists. Not so humble. But now let's go and have a look at the actual piece I've got in front of me, because it's nothing like any of these. So here it is. It's an iron box decorated with very fine gold damascening, or correctly, gold nunome-zogan, or kin nunome-zogan. Kyoto at the time was quite renowned for this kind of work. And you'd be forgiven for thinking this was by the Komai company, or Komai Otojiro, or any of the other, there were two or three other major companies that did very fine work. But this is quite distinct. This is not studio work. This is the work of an individual artist. I've not personally seen work quite as distinctive in the sense of being able to identify an individual maker. A lot of Komai work, for example, has a similarity to it. Just the way the gold is applied, there are aspects of the technical details on this that are a little different, which, you know, one would expect. You're talking of an artist of pretty high skill levels who's decided to branch out and do something quite different. Of course, their work isn't going to look exactly like the Komai studio, for example, where they've been doing the same thing for, you know, 50 years. So you've got quite a distinctive technique going on, and it's a very fine technique. The subject matter is, of course, benten or benzaiten. It was a Buddhist and slightly Shinto deity derived from the Hindu goddess Saraswati. Worship of this deity arrives in Japan around about the 7th century. She's always been a very popular deity. During the Edo period, so she was a personification of wisdom. And here she is with a biwa, the stringed harp-like instrument. And as here, most often seen on a dragon, sometimes on a giant white elephant. But dragons seem to be the preferred mode of transport for this deity. So let's have a look a little bit at some of the details we can discern. So now we're in a little bit closer, and we can examine the technique and also the condition, because of course I've got to clean this up a little bit and see if we can't make it sparkle a bit more. So I was saying how the technique itself is quite distinctive. The very best work of this type, this nunome-zogan, that was coming out of Kyoto in the late 19th century, has a richness, a lushness to it. The gold, in fact, has thickness that you can actually see when you look at the piece from an angle. You can see the light catching the side of the gold, and it really gives a sense of depth to the overlay. Lesser quality work, the kind of stuff you see that was made perhaps at the start of the 20th century, but some 19th century, the gold is a little thinner, and it's also more level with the surface, as though it's been painted on or electroplated on, whereas here you can actually see the thickness of the gold foil and the wire. I'm looking at these whiskers, for example. They have quite a distinctive body to them. What that does is, because when it's all finished and it's burnished and so forth, and you've got all these very delicate textures, like on these flames, got these little dot fading on the clouds, the light catches the edge of the gold. And so you have a sculptural quality to it. As I'm looking here, I can see a little reflection of light running around the edge of the dragon's forehead. And then as I turn, the light catches different areas. So it's not a flat picture. It does have a three-dimensional quality to it. And it's that kind of thing that distinguishes very fine nunome-zogan from the bog standard stuff. So these clouds are quite lovely. The first thing to note and sort of perhaps make a copy of is the lovely forms. They're really lovely shapes in themselves. I'll take some still photographs and put them on Patreon. So if you wanted to carve some clouds, these would be really nice models. And so what he's done, he's outlined the shape with wire. And then the inside is actually made by graduating tiny little dots. And what that probably is on the cross-hatched ground that he's cut, he's placed filings, gold filings, and very carefully worked it in to create this hazy effect, which is super delicate and speaks of remarkable control. And you can imagine the ground had to be cut really, really fine, because if your ground was too coarse, the gold would just stick in between the great big spikes that you've created. So we know to get this kind of delicate effect, the ground had to be almost like fine emery paper, so that you could literally place individual specks of gold filing in position. So now I'd like to contrast this technique to what he's done over here on these flames. So the flames are picked out in a solid piece of gold sheet, or perhaps built up with gold strips. And then he's used a pin punch to create a speckled texture just on the edges of the flame to give a sense of three-dimensionality to these areas. So it's sort of the reverse of the clouds. So this is all gold, and then it's got little black dots creating the modeling, as opposed to the other one, which was gold dots creating the modeling. But it's a lovely juxtaposition. So here again, you can see contrasted very beautifully and effectively the clouds outlined in gold, and then the tiny gold dots. And then here the flames in solid gold with tiny black dots. And then you've got this lovely sinuous dragon's body, which runs through the whole design here. And these little spikes, little fan of spikes here, are very considered detail that you can't help but notice, and it catches the light beautifully and echoes again here across the back. So I just want to point out some remarkable attention to line here, this back leg here. So this is obviously the part he wants to emphasize. So he's used a relatively thick piece of wire, still ridiculously thin, but compared to the rest that follows, this is the thick bit. Notice that line. Incredibly delicate scales. And then the line that defines the back of the leg is noticeably thinner than this line. Just like cartoonists today, in the manga tradition, when they're drawing the leading line, or the line that is perhaps forward, is thicker and stronger than the one behind. But it's these kinds of details that gives this piece its three-dimensionality and movement. It is quite humbling to think about how they prepared their materials, though. We can bring our attention over to the figure of Baizenten standing on the dragon here. The robes, this little dapier pattern in the folds. And sleeves with little squares
getting tiny and then getting bigger as they get to the edge of the swell. The amount of care and delicacy in such a small area really is quite remarkable. So now we come to have a look at the face of the goddess, and we can tell by the silver sulfide that it's obviously silver. I'm a little worried about this because there's some carbuncles here on the surface. Silver is very prone to oxidizing. Well, it's not oxidizing, is it? It's sulfurizing. And in so doing, the sulfur is being consumed. So when you clean off the silver sulfide, it's effectively rusted away, which is why often in work like this, the silver is fugitive and has just gone missing. I'm hoping there's enough here. I can see the eye and the eyebrow. It's ridiculously finely done. I have no idea. These men were just insane. It just makes me want to give up. So I'm going to have to be very, very careful how I clean this. But it's got to be done because really, I mean, the figure doesn't make much sense with no face. The other issue that I have to try to understand and do something about is this brown staining. Now, it could be any number of things. It could be oxidized urushi that was used to seal the iron patina. Or it could be rust that has grown underneath the lacquer and the wax and so forth and has spread. So I'm going to have to do some very careful investigation into the surface. Some areas have been quite worn and I can see the metal surface fairly well. Other areas it does look like it's got some kind of thick varnish, lacquer or waxy type coating. So I'm going to be like a painting restorer in the first instance and use various solvents in an inconspicuous area to see if I can get a sense of what is coating everything. And I shall proceed from there really and work in out of the way places and then just see how best to proceed. It's not a matter of just going straight in with a toothpick and rubbing away, because you can imagine everything would be destroyed. And it really is a very beautiful piece. And I learn a great deal about design, about the care they took, the care that's necessary, just by working on pieces like this. So I suppose I will always take on little jobs like this that are worth my effort. Because the end result feels like I'm earning good karma, merit, by doing good work for these long gone guys.
You see how the light plays across it, and it really does become very three-dimensional, magical almost, which of course a Buddhist goddess riding on a dragon is rather magical. You can see the shading effect really rather effectively. But the vision to conceive of this and then pull it together is something, isn't it?
So here's the side. So evidently our dragon with his heavenly passenger are flying over the sea, a raging sea. Again, really worth noting the lovely patterns, these little fingers of waves, beautifully designed, these lovely lines and these flowing waves, always with rhythm, always with rhythm. And what's really amazing here is none of these wires they seem to taper, rather. Right there, that gold wire tapers down. But yeah, I get the impression there's been an awful lot of coating applied. I'm a little bit perplexed by it. It seems quite heavy-handed, the varnish or whatever, so I'm quite keen to get to it and find out what exactly is going on. But I shall document this with some still photographs, and I'll put them on Patreon. So those of you who perhaps want to download them and trace them out, use them for engraving exercises or wire or nunome exercises, they'll be available for you. There we go. And one last thing to look at is the seal. And this is a really curious thing. It is exactly 1 centimeter square. And I measured that very, very carefully with a vernier gauge that's accurate to 1/100 of a mil. And it's exactly 1 centimeter square. That, I don't think, is an accident. But the degree of precision in that regard is trumped by the actual ground cutting. It's ridiculously difficult to show you this because it's so fine. But the ground that those letters or those seal characters are stuck onto is cut, it looks like, 4 different directions. So horizontal, vertical, and then diagonal, the 2 diagonals. I think you can just make out a slight impression of that structure. But there must be probably more than 15 cuts per millimeter there in each direction and in 4 directions. So it's just to give you a sense of how very fine that is. And then the gold is so carefully applied that the gold hasn't smudged. Those lines are tiny. So if I tell you that's 1 centimeter across, those wires, those tiny wires here, let me get in Soderfeld, those tiny wires here, it's a centimeter from here to there, 10 millimeters. So one of those wires is about 0.2 of a mil wide. The border is less than a millimeter. That must be about 1/3 of a mil, if that's 10 mil.
Yeah.
It's just ridiculous. And so precise. And one of the little lovely delights, I don't know if you can see it, but this outer border is one piece of wire, and where it comes in on one of the corners, I can't quite see it, it's got a little diagonal cut.
It's the top corner.
Yeah, this corner here. Okay. There's a little cut through there, like a woodwork joint. But that's just remarkable. Really, really remarkable work. And I'm glad we were able to see a little bit of the cross-hatching, because it does illustrate exactly the kind of finesse that goes into every stage of this work. Also, the underside doesn't look so thick with varnish and gloop. So I'm hoping that the iron condition is a little better than it first appears on the front. So it's one last look before we say goodbye to it in its present incarnation. It's a hinged box, actually. Inside is gilt copper, I think. These linings all come out. This is a pretty standard construction for boxes. I must have worked on dozens. This will slide out. The base will pop out. Similarly, this will come out of the iron, and this will pop out, which allows me to clean these up much more readily, and I can really make sure that the iron is all in good order on the inside. It just makes it a little easier to examine carefully. The feet, these feet will be attached through the iron with rivets into the iron base. Of course, we'll see that when we take the lining out. But it shouldn't take me too long to get this little beauty back to as good a condition as I can. And I'll show you when we're done. Thanks for watching.